everybody, and welcome to Slash Yell, the MMO podcast, bringing you the highlights of MMO news this week. What did I do wrong?
You didn't do anything wrong. I loved it. It's the person that's behind the camera that's not on this week's show that had issue with it, but we'll leave it at that.
Using his power. My name is Doc, and this week I have two awesome co-hosts, as always, and a third anonymous voice out in ether. So let's get right into it. Our first co-host of the week is Behalter.
Hey, what's going on, folks? Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely.
Of course, man. And, you know, Indigo.
Yep, me. I'll be here for a while. You're stuck with me, so get used to it.
So, gentlemen, let's get right into it. Behalter, how has your week been this week?
My week's been pretty good, pretty light. Not too much in the way of gaming. Excited for some Arterra news out of Wildstar, so that's pretty fantastic.
Yeah. For me, I'm super excited. This week, I got a brand new spanking computer. It's brand spanking.
No, it's a spanking computer.
Literally, like, I have to bend over to turn it on, and it spanks me and says, good job, and then calls me Nancy, which is weird.
Yourself something nice.
A brand new computer. It's the largest computer I've personally owned. It's huge, but I'm still setting it up, and I'm super afraid of saying the core word, because I'm afraid she's going to pop up and say something. What? So I have Windows 10. I've never had Windows 10. And you know how on Google you can say, okay, Google, and then it's like, yeah.
Never had that issue with Cortana.
Yeah, so I'm afraid, like, I just have this, like, deep down fear. I'm just be like, I love this character in Halo. And it's like, what do you want? What do you want me to do? So, but
I may not be Siri, but I will damn well try.
So that's basically my whole week. What about you, Doc?
Me, I've been trying to get a business going. We're just inching closer and closer together. We have a few more things to do, and I wanted to show this because I'm fucking proud of it. We finally got our merch in.
Woo!
So
nice.
This is one of the shirts I ended up taking and buying myself from the inventory. So,
oh, it's because you're not getting high off your own stash.
I can't. So, Trash Panda, you know? I had to do that because it's freaking cool. I have to make this work. I don't have a job anymore.
Well, and I know, as one of the founding members of Q Times, that we will be buying a good amount of stock from you and doing them as giveaways.
Yay, so. I could eat dinner.
Maybe pay for a six-pack or something, you know what I mean?
Exactly. But so yeah. let's move right on into our first thing of the week, and that is Slash Trade. Since everyone's new to this show, we divvy up parts of our show with, you know, old school taglines. If you put in your chat, you know, Slash Yell, Slash stuff like that. Slash Trade is where we talk about games and our impressions, what we've been playing, a little more in depth than our opinions on it. So I'm going to go back. I know I talked last week that I've been playing a little more Blade and Soul and Warframe. I kind of mostly dropped off from Warframe. It's so unuser-friendly that it's aggravating. We tried to jump in with Tekken Daggers, Rabid, to play with her some PvP, and we tried to do stuff with a smaller group of us, and the game wouldn't even tell us why we got it wrong. It would just kick us out completely, or just stop us completely.
Yeah, and it was weird.
Nothing. Like, big core game mechanics, you don't understand until you have to go do it yourself. And they have PDF files, essentially, in there, and they're not useful. At all. And I just said, forget it. I'm just going to go back to Blade and Soul and try to find something else to fill my time with. Blade and Soul, I've been having some fun with. I am slogging through the PvE, though, as much as having fun with the Kung Fu Master, which is straight up my jam right now, because I get to Kung Fu kick things, and then the moment I trip them up, I literally just go into full mount and just beat the ever-loving crap out of them, and I'm like, I do this in the gym on my own! So, combat aside, the PvE is still just the harshest thing for me to get into in this game and testing. And now I'm just kind of looking forward also to March, see what other two games I want to just dedicate most of my time to. Now I'm debating between, like, SWTOR, Wildstar, and SWTOR or Wildstar or some other superhero MMO, because I need, like, superpowers that aren't just magic. But none of them are good, so I gotta figure something out. That's just me.
Did you just say that Wildstar wasn't good?
No. Superhero MMOs.
Oh, there's only really I'm so sorry. I totally
none of them are good.
That was my fault. I was like, we like that game.
No, I don't know. I've been playing more and more. I got my 50. I got my warrior up a little bit. I'm working on a medic. But I've been mostly playing Blade and Soul because I want to be able to get through as much as I can.
Yeah.
WildStar, I spent over a year on and I love it. And I need to get back into raids. But that's been the kind of the focus on my slash trade for this.
For sure.
And that's really just me. Indigo, what about you?
So I was playing Warframe with you a little bit last week because you guys were adamant about me getting started. Apparently, I had made a character a while ago, but when I downloaded the game this time, it was like, oh, hey, you've never played. Make a character. And I chose a character. I made that character. And then I played through the intro, and as soon as I got into my ship after the intro part, it changed my character to something completely different. And then I was like, how do I get, like, I want to play that other character. I don't want to play this one. And then I found out that you can't, you have to pay in-game money to change your Warframe, and or you could just make a new account. So then I had to make a new account with a different email to play the character that I wanted to play. It was, it wasn't the best. It needs some help. Warframe needs a little bit of help. But that's kind of it for my MMOs this week. Because my computer was slowly dying, I wasn't really able to do much hard intensive gaming. So I played some Diablo with Doc and Krug a bunch. We've been playing that. And Hearthstone. Those have basically been my games because that's what my computer was able to handle. But now that I have this monster beast, I'm looking forward to hopping back into actual gaming. But what about you, Behalter? You said you didn't really have that much gaming this week.
No, not too much. Yeah, WildStar raiding, you know, that's pretty much my go-to.
Only that thing that Doc or myself can really get into. Just that.
We're only 7-9 in Datascape now this week. So
we're almost done with
nothing,
it.
Nothing.
Avatis is our bitch. It's just...
Yeah. It's only a matter of time.
You know, Time Travel is probably listening into this going, okay, so up in difficulty. Got it. And that's, you know, that's mostly most of the slash trade stuff. So we're going to go into the big meat and potatoes this week, slash zone. This is our big discussion. We dig highlights of the week from MMO news, and we all kind of give our opinions and our thoughts on it, what we play, what we think. And first up is the Secret World. And the Secret World has some pretty cool big changes. In fact, they're changing up their membership rewards. It's going to take effect in early 2016, and please forgive me, I've not played a bunch of the Secret World, so a lot of this to me is going to sound a little like gibberish. So here are some of the bullet points. It's a 30% increase to all of the experience you earn, a 50% boost into all your black bullions gained, a 20% extra capacity, 8-hour mission cooldowns, 18-hour raid lockout timers. That's actually really short for a lockout timer. 18 hours? Holy crap. A 2 lockout timer resets every month, roughly. A store discount. Everybody, store discount, please. Also, you get bonus points, like they do, like a stipend, like a SWTOR, and free anima leaps. So this is, I have not played a whole bunch of Secret World already. This sounds really cool. It gives you a much bigger incentive to be subscribed or be purchased.
Yeah, so I played Secret World before it was... oh god, that sounds so hipster. I played Secret World before it was a free-to-play game. No, so I played it a while ago. I loved this game, and I loved how the gameplay worked. The fact is that you weren't set to a specific class. Like, it was free reign. There wasn't any leveling system. Like, you just played, and the experience bar filled up, and you got an additional point. The more points you got, the more things you got to be, you know? And then it went free to play, and I went back into it for a while. And they've made a substantial amount of just like gameplay changes, like how the game works, like difficulty level. There's been a massive amount of changes from when it originally came out to now, and they're continually improving it. Funcom is honestly a really, really awesome company, and I want to start getting more into their content. These changes, I don't remember exactly what they were before, but these all seem really, really fair.
It's kind of a revamp of their old membership system.
Yeah, so they did have a membership like bonuses like this, but I still think this is a very fair. If I'm paying $15 a month each game, I'm getting my points and I'm getting a discount from the store. Like, that's awesome. Like, that's really, really, really awesome. Because if you don't raid, the raid lockouts don't mean anything. The lockout timer reset twice a month doesn't mean anything. So this, I think, affects all players. PvPers, raiders, everything. So, I like it.
It feels like they were... You know how we talked about on Strange Tales how WildStar took a look at everybody else's free-to-play and went, this is what we'll do, and this is a game you're going to hear about a lot today because a lot of that WildStar is happening today. The Secret World took that idea and said, let's do what they did, and then take some of their ideas, and then some of everybody else's ideas, and then revamp this shit.
Yeah.
That's mostly to think of. And store discount. That...
Hey,
I'm done right there.
If that's
mic drop.
Honestly, store discount or a stipend of points, I'm happy with one or the other. The fact is that they give you both. It's just, which is crazy.
It's cherries on top. It's fantastic.
Yeah, exactly. Like it, and I think it works really well for them because this is encouraging people to actually sub versus hoping that the microtransactions work. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
they're now guaranteed X amount of people are going to be subbed versus hoping that, like, each month you're hoping that we get enough content into the shop to make sure that people are actually going to buy this stuff versus going, okay, we know we have this. We can focus on larger projects versus having to focus purely on shop content because that's what's going to keep the doors open next month. But...
They get to use those points as an indicator of like what's selling in our shop as well.
Yeah, exactly.
So people are getting that stipend and they keep using it. They go, oh, these are really popular items. So, you know, discounts won't really need to apply to these so much. Oh, these items over here could probably use some love. We'd love to push this content. Hey, your store discount with their sale and everything else. Go buy, bye bye.
Yeah, exactly.
It's nuts. And already, if you don't know about Secret World, it is an MMO where you take. You're part of one of three organizations. You're either part of the Illuminati, the Triad, or what's the third one? The Templar?
Mm-hmm.
And you go into a realm of MMO where it doesn't really go. Everyone's got tights and magic and swords and sorcery. They kind of got a little bit of that too.
They absolutely have all of that.
Let's just throw in Cthulhu for the hell of it.
Yeah.
Or let's go to a theme park that's supremely haunted and their questing system is some of the more inventive in MMOs from what I've seen and told.
There's an in-game internet browser in the game because they know that some puzzles are difficult to solve and that you're going to have to use the internet to solve them. Like they actually put real puzzles in the game. It's not just like move this block over two spaces and it falls down into a thing. They're like, who was the composer? You're trying to figure out a guy's password to his computer. And the hint is, you know, Stars and Spangled, you know, like a name's like a song title. And you're like, okay, all right. You Google the song title and you're like, oh, he has this poster that's got the year on it. So it's clearly this same thing. So this is the composer's name. You put the composer's name and it unlocks it. And you're like, holy shit, like, I feel like I accomplished something.
I feel like I need a tinfoil hat to play this game.
Yeah, no, it's...
Experiences, man!
It puts you into a current world, but you're able to see and experience things that other people don't necessarily see, like zombies and ghosts and Cthulhu and just a ton of different monsters and genres. It's horror-based. It's a lot of fun. If you haven't given it a try, go out there and try it. It's really nice. Oh, excuse me. Yeah, you're right.
Wow. Doc? Cool. All that. Yeah, okay. No. Let's go on. But now, yeah, let's go in the next game.
Walter, have you had a chance to play Secret World before?
No, I haven't. I hear a lot of buzz about it being really good. You know, gameplay aspects are really good, but I haven't had a chance to hop in it yet. But the membership rewards look pretty good, so yeah. Maybe that might be one I dip my toes in.
Sure, absolutely.
And next we have, well, once again, WildStar. It's a WildStar heavy thing, and we're going to all have some opinion on this. And I swear this is not just STOS, it just kind of is. WildStar just announced this week Destination Arcterra, which is a better name than fucking, what's that snow thing?
It's not the Tundra Dome.
The not Tundra Dome. So for those of you that don't know, regardless of what you hear on the internet, the game is still going on. They have a new drop coming out. This is going to be, you're going to be sent to previously undiscovered location on the planet Nexus, where you will find essentially a smorgasbord of stuff going on. For some of the things you can see, like, it's nuts. I'll let you guys talk about this because my mind can't wrap around it right now.
First of all, this area is not attached to any other current zone right now. You have to adventure there separately. Like, you have to take a teleporter to get you there, kind of like when you go to the moon, basically. So they had a live stream this last on Friday going in further into – was it Friday? Yeah, Friday.
Yeah.
Where they went deeper into the content that they were showing off. I believe this is not on PTR yet.
It will be soon, though.
Yeah, it was TM. But yeah, it looks really interesting. Was there anything like particular that you were most excited about, Doc or Ballhalter?
I'm gonna say. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was gonna say. First off, snowballing boss encounters and the amount of events they showed up on the stream is insane. They want you to be fully invested into the zone and to pretty much make this your new home. You're not gonna be in the cities as much, hopefully, with Destination Arcterra. And the fact that every time you beat something, it causes the snowball to go down the mountain a little further, and something new pops up. You kill that, something new pops up. You discover this.
Something bigger and stronger, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool.
And it's,
rewards go with it.
What I noticed is very faction-based, you know, or at least that's what they were advertising and showing on the live stream, is that if your faction is able to do this, then your faction gets access to this specific zone that the other faction doesn't get. So they have to fight to get access to that, which I thought was a very interesting direction for them to go.
And then what else we got here?
Walter, you were gonna say something as well. What were you?
Well, on the live stream they showed the map and just all over the place. There looks like there's so much to do. They're pumping a lot of new content into it. So that's what I'm really excited for. Just the whole, you know, anything they can do to make it so more people are playing this game, I'm always on board for.
A lot of the content, dailies. Yeah, I noticed that a lot of the content was, in fact, group-based. You know, yeah. The fact is that there were five-man bosses. Like, it was single-person, then three-person bosses, and five-person bosses. And, you know, it's very, very group content-oriented, which I hope works out very well, because I didn't feel that in... I didn't feel like the last big group content, at least the large group content, didn't work out very well. What was it? Where it was like the 40-person like PvE or 20-person PvE where you had a timer and you had to get this stuff done by...
Lightspire?
And not the Lightspire. It was... maybe it was Lightspire. Maybe I'm wrong. Yeah.
I don't know. Group content in games, every game is trying to push for more group content. And there's this weird thing in game communities where they always say, we want more group content, we want more group content, and they give you the group content, and they go, yeah, about that. Everyone's a scrub but me, so I don't want group content. Well, and I can see the developers going, oh my god, I hate you guys, I hate all of you.
I mean, they're having to play this game between like becoming like group content focused or becoming SWTOR. Because, I mean, you know what I mean? Like, at what point are you just like... Ow. At what point are you playing your MMO, massive multiplayer online game, and playing it as a solo player game? So I get why they're pushing solo or group content. Like, that's not my question at all. I'm just glad that this is, like, from what I saw, at least, it was 1, 3, and 5 person groups. And it wasn't necessarily like you needed to group up 20 people to go and do this, which I didn't think worked as well as they were hoping. But it was a lot of fun when the very rare groups that I did get to go through, it was so much fun to do. It sucked. Like, it was a daily. And it was like, oh, today do I get to do this daily? No, I don't get to do it. Today? Yes, today I get to do it. So, I'm looking forward to this. I will say the prettiest lighting I've seen in WildStar so far.
Or is that... the zone looks beautiful.
Yeah. I mean, like, out of all the zones that I've seen, this is literally the prettiest, like, visual lighting, like, across the board. And, like, depending on how you, like, where you were and during the times of the day, like, the sky will change color. You'll have, like...
Weather has an effect in Arterra.
Yeah, weather has an effect. All of those things were really, really
awesome. I think we just glossed over that. We didn't realize that. And that was almost a throwaway line. Weather has a legitimate effect while you're in Arterra. It's not just, oh, my field of view went down. When the blizzards come in... players actually have an objective to go through the blizzard and to go do this content while this blizzard's happening. And that ties into that secret event you talk about for the factions. Mm-hmm. So it is time-based. And it's a little predictable. They did say it's roughly in this time frame. It happens and refreshes and whatnot. But it's not just a little weather effect that changes the lighting. It's, oh, it's so pretty. Like, no, you have to get yourself ready for what's happening because the game does change a little bit. Your adventure does change a little bit. They also said in the live stream there's going to be a new raid coming out possibly soon. They're going to put on the PTR. They said a little bit here and there about it. I don't want to go too far in.
They did say it was going to be Red Moon. Like they flat out said
it's going to be Red Moon. I have NDAs that I still have signed somewhere in a file, and I'm very certain Don Tellio will go, hey, buddy, about that.
They it is out there. They said it's going to be Red Moon. They haven't said, like,
what's in it.
What's in it? None of that, but yeah. Also in chat, there the KDM says that there is 20 man content in this newest update, but it's kind of the pinnacle of the stuff there. So it's the big.
You gotta work for it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I'm glad that we've dropped down servers. I'm hoping that this pushes a bunch of new people into it. What are you doing?
Drunk Arterra streams.
Okay, first of all, you just put the word drunk in front of everything that you think about, and it's somehow genius. You're like,
how is that not awesome?
Drunk smite stream.
Just get Mog Nation or Red Velvet Ninjas together, and just all of us go on a stream, and every time we down something, take a shot and see if we can get to the 20-man stuff. How is that not awesome? How?
Anyways, on the next piece of news, Neverwinter Night.
It's a social drinking game.
We can do anything drunk, Doc. We just can't do it on Sundays because most people work on Mondays. I'm just saying.
You people and your lives
and jobs. You responsibilities. You kids, get off my yard. Anyways, so we are legitimately going to move on. The next or the last piece of stuff in Slash Zone is Neverwinter Night Online is changing how their mounts work. So yes, their mounts, as in those things that you get on and you ride, they go
fast. I've never seen a mount in Neverwinter.
Yes, they have mounts. So previously how it worked is your mount had a specific speed associated with it. So it's like, oh, if you got this specific mount, it was the slow speed. And then you'd play that and you would get the next mount and the next mount would be faster speed. Well, now what they're doing is they're actually allowing you to assign whatever speed to whatever mount. So you can choose the slowest speed, but they don't know why you would. So visually, it's not going to matter what mount you have. You can have whatever mount you want and choose what speed you want. The other thing that they're changing about it is mounts also used to have active and passive abilities. So, like, you would be able to do an extra, like, couple-second charge or, like, damage wouldn't deal as much to you, like, while you're mounted. Stuff like that. And they're changing that to match the same. Is now each mount will have an active and a passive slot that you can actually choose which one of those, what active and what passive that mount has. So it's not specific to the mount.
So basically, mounts are just skins now.
That's exactly what it is now. Before, it was very specific to, oh, he's riding this mount. That means this is the speed that they're using. This is the bonuses that they're using. Now they've completely changed it, and they're now allowing you to have whatever mount. Because the problem is people had the faster mounts and were stuck using the faster mounts, but they really wanted the mount that looked like this. And I get that. As a player, I want a cool mount. Like, having speeds associated with each mount kind of sucked. The active and passives made sense because they were mount specific. And it's like, oh, this is an armored horse. Clearly, the horse would take less damage. You know what I mean? Like, but they're changing it up a little bit to match so you can choose whatever you want.
This is also a game where a man is half dragon and breathes fire. So yeah, realism of the armored horse is definitely paramount.
This is the D&D MMO though. So
illegitimately D&D MMO.
Yeah, I mean this is the Dungeons and Dragons MMO. So it makes sense. there is half dragons in D&D. There's half dragons in Neverwinter. Makes sense.
Every game just needs a half dragon.
100% agreed. I mean, WildStar has it with Draken.
What?
Where do you think the word Draken comes from?
The name, not the species.
I know, but it's partially dragon. Species. He's got a dragon tail. He's got horns like a dragon. Yeah, it doesn't breathe fire, but that's because it's partially human. Don't you judge me right now, Doc. Don't you dare judge me. I will get rid of you and put Krug back on the show. That's how angry I am at you.
Wow. Wow. Shots fired.
That's okay. Now I have to play nice.
But that's the last bit of news for Slash Zone. The next section we're going to is Slash LFG. So looking for group. This is where we talk about MMOs that haven't come out yet. We just talk about betas or you know, stuff that's out on PTR, stuff like that. So go for it. No, go.
Actually, I know nothing of Star Citizen. Like, I have also no interest in Star Citizen. All I know is there's spaceships. That's about it.
So Star Citizen has an ongoing show called 10 for the Chairman, which is 10 questions submitted by the player base. Well, or the future player base that is given to basically the president of the company. And he answers the questions. Of course, they vet the questions. It's not like they're like, this random guy's like, oh, yes, I want to ask him what his favorite color is. And then they come up and they're like, why hasn't this game come out yet? Like, it's not like they vet the questions. They talk about it. And this is their 76th episode.
Holy crap.
That is ridiculous.
They tied SUS.
How often do they do these? Are they releasing like 2 a week?
I don't know. I mean, they have been out. I mean, the game's been in beta / alpha for like
5 years.
Yeah. Beta / alpha / release for God knows how long.
Yeah, it's been out there for a while. But I think this is really cool. I think this is a really interesting way to create transparency with the game. I mean, transparency. Again, they get to choose what questions they're being asked. But I think it's a really interesting way to go about it. You know, I think a lot of gaming studios are trying to figure out the best way to communicate with their community other than forums, because I think they realize that forums are literally like the home for
a cesspool.
Yeah, it's just a cesspool of bitching and complaining. So they're
that's Reddit.
They're like, yeah, that is Reddit. Oh fuck, no, but that's where Reddit is where they breed. This is where they go and like feed. Like that's the difference. so
God, we're dicks.
Yeah, I know. So I mean, WildStar has their live streaming, which I think when it was before the game came out, they were massive, and they're continually doing that, and that's how we're getting most of our WildStar information. Like this stuff is on forums, but most people are hearing it from their live streams. This is their kind of version of that, where they're doing this. I think it's really cool. He answers a bunch of questions. You guys have to watch the video to go through it. And if you have the time to go through the last 76 episodes,
jeez, that's the shock.
Go right through it.
Yeah. I mean, EQ Next had the round table. That didn't last for a whole lot of time. WildStar did theirs for a while. ESO does theirs occasionally. Blizzard is Blizzard. I'm surprised that 10 for the Chairman has lasted that long.
Yeah.
And it's not a community creation. It is a studio creation. That's the shocker. I mean, the only other thing I could think of that can be that in-depth for that period of time, depending on how long the development cycle goes for the game, would be Crowfall. Crowfall is doing alpha streams of the creation of the game.
Yep.
On top of streaming of it. Like, this is... I can't tell if they just said, I don't care what the community said, we're going to still do the show and see who sticks around for it. Or if the community was just that into it, it's a shocker. So
I think it's a good idea. I know on the previous show on Quarter Up, we talked about NDAs and whether NDAs help games or not. Like, this is a way to get around that kind of NDA, in the sense where it's like they're here to talk to you and get the information that they want on a regular basis. You know, if you stick yourself and say every single week or, you know, Every other week, we're going to sit down and we're going to talk about this game to get the players more information. Even if you're rehashing the same information, players feel like you're communicating a lot better than when it's just, you know, when it's not scheduled or not known when they're going to talk, you know? And so I think this helps Star Citizen. Like I said, I've gotten into it once or twice. It's one of those games I'm not comfortable in the beta. I want to wait until the game comes, like, gets a little bit further before I go back into it, because I didn't know what the fuck I was doing. I just had no idea what I had to go online.
You just didn't spend enough money.
Yeah, I had to go online and, like, read other stuff of, like, what the fuck am I supposed to be doing right now to figure out how to play that game? And I was like, all right, I'm going to wait until they, like, introduce a little bit more to figure out how it goes. Yeah. But, yeah, this is cool. Watch it. Have a check. And let us know if you guys think this is something cool. Like, I'm intrigued
to
know
if other people should do more often.
Yeah. Is this a good thing for gaming studios? So should gaming studios that are creating games like this?
Actually, that's a question we ask ourselves. Because, I mean, we've already talked about people that have failed to do it. I don't know why they don't go back to doing it. Are they just afraid of saying, oh, it didn't work the first time because of the personalities or the format? This is something that I believe game companies should be doing more of.
Well, the thing that strikes me about this one in particular is there's the accountability level is huge on this, because it's not just, you know, somebody working for the studio or, you know, one of many developers. This is the guy.
Yeah.
This is the guy that's putting this together. And if he slips or says something, or total accountability. That's nuts.
I can only imagine his shareholders just shitting their pants every time one of the episodes goes on YouTube or something. They're just like, oh, God.
Hey,
oh God,
with please. The amount of money that they've made from Kickstarter, they shouldn't have a single fucking shareholder. Just saying. Like, they may that may be the reason why they're able to do this, because they're like, who are we going to piss off? The people that already bought the game? Fuck them.
Already
like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, maybe that's the sign of success. Maybe microtransaction game, not microtransaction, micro funding is the way to fucking push big games like this. Because this game is fucking huge.
We're literally talking about the two most funded games at the moment, not funded by like major studios, Crowfall and Star Citizen.
Yep.
How well they're doing it. And we were all stoked. And once again, because of all our backgrounds, we were all stoked in the beginning when they were doing a bunch of stuff for WildStar, and then it all disappeared, and we're like, well, I guess...
I'm intrigued. Anyways, let's move on. We've talked about this
for a while. All right, I want to get each of your opinions on this, because this is interesting. There is a game going into beta soon called Wild Terra. They just released an announcement trailer. So for some information, it's going to be an early access build. You can go pay to get in and try it out and test it out. It's going to be $15. They say it's going to have a focus more on survival and cooperation with yourself and others and crafting and whatnot than direct combat. So while most MMOs, their crafting system is part of the game but not a focus, supposedly in Wild Terra, crafting and farming and creating things is going to be a primary driver of the game. And, you know, combat might happen once in a while. You get to become a king out of it if you do well enough. And it looks like a game.
It looks like a game I would either play on my phone or Facebook made it.
So the questions, it looks like a browser game.
Exactly. Yeah. So the questions I have for you guys is, what do you think of a game like this with its premise, blah, blah, blah. It's looks so far, because I'm going to be totally shallow here and go, wow, that's a game. That's Ultima Online there, buddy. Let's return back to UO. And how do you feel about this change, where it almost feels like they're taking more of a page from survival games more than MMOs and trying to turn that into an MMO?
Walter, why don't you start off?
What's your exact question?
So the question is, how do you feel about this? They're charging you to get into this game, an MMO that's not yet complete.
It's only $15.
But it has a focus that is the complete opposite of other MMOs, and it looks like that.
I mean, I guess it depends on who they're marketing it to. If they're marketing to people that really want to do crafting and that's their bread and butter, does it really matter what it looks like?
I mean, we'll have to ask
Spreadsheet. I personally wouldn't pay $15 for it, I'm saying.
Yeah, we'll have to ask Spreadsheet Boy next week. Maybe this is, like, a little bit better than like, it's less graphical, but, you know, it's straight numbers. But I don't
know.
No,
it's not. Shut up.
He speaks from on high.
I got to be honest with you. I have zero interest in this. The fact is that the transitions in this video are higher quality than the game itself. Mind you, like seriously, it's like you got like little ashes of fire.
You got that After Effects smoky stuff going around.
It's like,
the
man,
particle effects are selling the shit out of this game right now.
I have zero interest in this game. Like, it looks like a game I would have played on my first PC tower back in the day. And even though graphics aren't the number one thing for me, it just takes me out of all interest. Like, it's that far gone. Like, I can play Minecraft and just be like really happy with it.
Yeah, I'm gonna be a major hypocrite in saying the graphics are horrible, I don't want to play this game, because I am being hypocritical in saying that. And I thought about, you know, why I'm being hypocritical in saying that, and I said, well, there are other games that I don't know what Wildterra is trying to capture. Are they trying to capture a previous era of MMOs? Are they so confident in their mechanics that they don't care about what it's going to look like? Because if this game was in a world that I can run around in third or first person, like, say, you know, Crawlfall, Minecraft, World of Warcraft, everything else, I'd be much more involved in the survival aspect of my community than just right-click tile, right-click tile, right-click tile, right-click tile, and craft. I don't know what they're going with on the graphical end of it. The idea for crafting as being a big driving force of the game, that sounds unique. It sounds interesting. I like the fact that everyone's kind of going, yeah, you know, everyone's on the combat heavy focus. Let's go into something else, because old MMOs did that. And, you know, let's see what we can bring back from that era and make it a thing again.
Well, the difference between an MMO that's old and is still going using these graphics is very different than a game. What?
You look the, man, the man on high forgot to change the title of our channel about more than half an hour into our show.
I saw that as well. I wasn't going to say anything, though.
Oh, I'm going to totally call him out. You know why? Because he can't see me, right?
He can see you and say stuff. So
it's just, I love watching his face right now. And for those of you that are watching, it's just.
Anyways, no. So, like I said, an older game that is now still using these graphics. Like, I give WoW a hard time because I think WoW really needs a new fucking engine. But, like, there's a difference between an old MMO that is still live versus an MMO that is coming live now.
Yeah, yeah.
In this day, that are using the older stuff. So,
So now this game is coming out early access for $15. Is there any payment model after that? Nothing.
No.
I will literally update this when I find out more information about it. That's mostly what I've got on it. And it's just, it's the biggest question mark I've seen lately in MMO games, because of this combination, the early access and the point of the game and the graphics. I'm being such a hypocrite going, bad graphics, they're bad, I don't want to play this game. It's a throwback. I don't even know if I want a throwback. This definitely is like, people say, oh, do people really want this again? Like, I know, I really don't.
Yeah.
I kind of want to keep going. Yeah. I spent $1,600 minimum on my PC. that isometric bear is not going to cut it anymore.
But this is for your phone, so.
Yeah, right? It better damn well be.
I mean, I could see this being a phone game, like a click game where you're sitting on your phone and you're just like, oh, now go craft that. Move over there. Anyways.
It's kind of like a game I used to play called Whack Foo, which was...
Oh, I've heard of Whack. I never played it, though.
Less pretty.
This is RuneScape Ultima Online level here. We're getting back into like 1998.
Yeah,
that's what it feels like. But not that logo. That logo is good old 2015 high resolution.
That name though, Wildterra.
Wildterra.
I can't tell if they're trying to like use like like, they're like, oh, we're going to steal Wildstar's, the first name of Wildstar, and then we're going to take Terra, which is also a game, and we're going to just mash that title together. Like,
SOE, baby.
Yeah.
Their entire player base is just going to be pissed off from multiple angles. Like, what is this? It's not what I thought I was buying. It doesn't look wah.
Well, and it's funny, if you watch the video, like, what, one of the characters has a witch hat on and a cloak, but is like wielding a sword. Like, I don't know what's going on in this.
Better question is, why are we still talking about this for so long?
Because we're so
raptured with
it. So baffled by it. You know what? Do you know what it is? The video
keeps looking at a relic, is what we're looking at.
The video keeps playing, and I keep seeing those fucking high level fucking transitions, and I'm just like, God damn. They spent more money on the computer and the fucking software to build this video than they did on the whole game.
I think that's really what it is that we went, wow. So someone in chat said, what about Realm of Mad God? It's recently released, has incredibly old school graphics, but still works for what it is. That is some loud music. Why is it so loud? Holy crap.
You're right there, buddy?
Oh, my ears.
Did you go to their website?
I accidentally right-clicked, said go to website. So I don't know. Realm of the Mad God has a style to it.
Yeah. There's a difference.
It's very sleek style.
And we talked about this with Minecraft. Yes, Minecraft isn't the highest graphics, but it is a specific style. This, like, when people talk about, like, style for, like, comic books, they never refer to the 90s being good comic book styles. Like, I feel the same way with gaming. Like, yes, old pixelated games or, like stuff like that, it that's a style. No one has gone back to the 90s to bring the 90s graphics to the 2000s yet. You know what I mean? Like, it's not that far back to be cool again.
This is just a style that feels like it was the transitional period between, you know, the 8-bit style that Realm of Mad God is using to anything else after this. That's just me, though. We really should move on from this. We are dwelling way too much on the curiosity of Wild Terra. So also in beta and alpha, we have here's what I love about when we talk about World of Warcraft is that when you talk about World of Warcraft on other gaming podcasts, and we did it on Strange Tales, and I love it when you guys do it on Wildcast, and other games do it too, they always refer to it like fucking Voldemort. The game that shall not be named. Sure, if you give it its name, it has power, and it becomes more and takes your subscribers away from you. But World of Warcraft has Legion coming out, and they've been releasing more and more about it, and like the armor sets, the raid gear sets, the pets coming out. They give you just enough to, like, just tap into that vein so you can come back for more. And this time they have the Azuna preview. They have a YouTube video for it. Actually, it's a user, yeah, FreeDJ4.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is a user-created content, which I think is really cool. It's kind of something similar that I've seen in other MMOs where they... like the actual company makes these. Well, they'll show you the world and kind of explore. It's really nice music in the background, really nice visual area. Again, I still think the game needs a new complete engine and an upgrade to realize that they're no longer, you know.
But their choice is specific, and they've said it many times.
Yes.
Their choice is to get as many people to play the game as possible on as many configurations. And even now, if you wanted to play Legion out the box, that same machine that would have run vanilla on like medium settings isn't going to cut it anymore. So
no, I'm aware.
They have increased the horsepower of the game, just has always been in minor increments as the game has evolved.
Yeah, I think though, instead of like when they look at like the standard of what computers are using and they say, this is the average players right here, they go, okay, average players right here, we should make the graphics over... here.
Doesn't matter about your graphics if you can pull off an art style like that.
You mean
God
square?
Damn, that is pretty. Come on, dude. You can totally knock on like on
no. Look,
pixel density and everything else. But when you can pull off just the detail and the aesthetic as hard as they do.
Oh, look, and I am aware that them trying to create a new engine for this would take them, like, another 10 years. Like there's going to be, like, 100 more expansions by the time they would honestly be able to recreate this entire world with a higher, like, it's physically fucking impossible for them to do that. I mean, they've got the money to do it, but I don't think that they have the physical amount of time to do it. And I get that. And again, I said I will give a leeway to a game that's been out for a long time that has lower end graphics. Hell, I'm subscribed to WoW right now, so I mean, I can't really, I'm handing them money, so I can't really give it too much shit about it.
The more I see Legion, the more I kind of want to throw money. And then I went, no, but this is like what Walter was saying before the show. This is slash fic. This is an expansion full of slash fic. You want Illidan? Here's your Illidan. You want your Outworld? Here's your Outworld. You want your demons? Here's your demons. Now just give me all your money. And that's what I think of Legion. Like, God, can you guys troll any harder? And I love it. But I don't want to give you my money yet.
Yeah. I still really love that, like, the fact that players are creating content like this. Like, they're going into PTR. They're admiring the worlds around it. They're creating this video. And then bringing out to all of us, if you're debating on whether or not you want to go into Legion, I'm not saying that this video is going to make you change, but it brings it back to a nostalgia level that you used to have if you ever played and going, wow, this, all right, I kind of want to try it again. You know what I mean?
So I have a question for both of you guys. This is not part of the docket. I just thought about this right now looking at the Legion thing, and we're talking about selling people on stuff. So out of all the games you played, what was one of the weirdest selling points of a game? Like, you saw a game, you're like, man, whatever. You saw this one thing and went, oh, I'm in. This is like, I'll give you my money now. What's one of the weirdest things? I saw the Legion stuff, and I made that joke about Illidan and everything else. And what sold me on this game to the point where I am just itching to hide my wallet from myself is the fact that Tauren have moose antlers now. And I don't know why, but that makes me want to play so I can roll a Tauren with moose antlers. How fucking weird is that? This whole video that we're seeing right now, this whole website of leaks, and then moose Tauren. Well, Alter's like, I don't know.
I don't know.
I will say, like, in past games that I was meh about, not meh about, but like the thing that sold me is humor. I'll be honest with you, it could be the darkest game in the world. If you have an ounce of humor, like good humor, I'm in. Like, the first trailer I ever saw for Wildstar was the video where they're like, go to Nexus, they said, ripe with villages, they said. And then, like, you watch him just get the shit kicked out of him over and over again. That video, like, it had no gameplay whatsoever. I was like, I'm fucking in. I am in. Let's do this. This game could have looked like Wild Terra, all right? And because that video made me fucking laugh, it made me laugh. It got me excited. It got me enthralled to figure out, like, okay. And it tells you a ton of information about the game, too. It tells you about all of the classes. It tells you what you're going to experience. And I loved that video. I loved that piece of content. And that sells me when a game can be funny and give information. I'm 100% in, no matter what the game is. Bahal, can you think of anything?
Not really. I mean, backpacks in Guild Wars 2.
Actually, that's another weird selling point. I saw that. I'm like, oh, I have a backpack on myself? It's not a cape anymore?
No.
Yeah, I don't buy this.
Well, I mean, you got to carry your stuff somewhere.
It's completely aesthetic.
Like, does anyone else think about that while playing MMOs? You're like, man, where am I storing all of this?
All the time.
It's the magic pocket of things like, here's the random sword I picked up. Here's the random gun I picked up.
Yeah.
I don't know where I'm putting all this.
Like, it reminds me of, like, those videos. It's like, where were you carrying that gun? You're like, you don't need to know. You're like, yeah.
I ran the whole way here, too.
Yeah, I mean, I think Black Desert tries to do that a little bit. Like, if you want to go farming for items and stuff like that, which is a huge part of that game, you actually have to rent a truck, basically, and you have to take your horses, not a truck, it's a trailer, basically, and you have to take your horses, and you can rent horses as well, and you have to ride them all the way back to the area you want to farm, then you have to let them sit there on the side, and then farm the shit out of the creatures you want to kill, then you take those items and have to put them in that, and then take them all the way back to town, because there's no, like, insta-teleport.
That seems like the webcomic version of an explanation of why these things happen in games. I don't know if I need a literal explanation of why I'm me farming these things. Well, wait, guys, I'm gonna go farm this item. Like, go get my fucking horse.
I gotta go get my horse. I gotta go get my trailer. And you can't, again, you can't teleport to these locations. You actually have to walk to these places. So you're just like, fuck.
You get into the mindset of a game. Now that the game looks so pretty, like you're actually there, now it's time for you to actually live it. You must walk the entire distance with your
Welcome
horse.
To second job.
You didn't do that spreadsheet right. You forgot your TPS report.
Minus 50 DKP.
No.
Traffic on the parkway. You're 25 minutes late.
That's how they would explain cues.
That's the raid boss. There you go. That's the raid boss. It's fucking LA traffic. Like, you get flown to LA for work. You now have to deal
now
with
loading.
LA traffic.
Now loading.
Oh, God. I'm just imagining, like, Office Space, someone sitting there listening to rap, and then, like, someone walks by, and like, I'm gonna lock this. Anyways, so the last, that was the last bit of news for LFG. There is a lot of beta news that is out there right now. There is a lot of games currently in beta. Like we said, Crowfall's in there. They're doing live streams left and right. Legion there. We're gonna talk about, Wildstar. Once Wildstar hits PTR, we'll bring that into LFG. So there's a lot of stuff coming out. If there's a specific game you guys want us to start paying close attention to, please make sure to let us know, because we'll add that to our list of stuff that we will talk about here.
The show is still evolving.
Yeah, exactly. This is episode 2, and we've already got rid of Krug, so we're already. Fucking,
you're ahead of the game.
10 times better.
Yeah, we forgot to let you guys know that Behalter's the new raid.
Krug said the man on high
is not
like,
pleased.
Oh, do I say something? Do I not? Anyway. So the last part of the show that we like to do is called Slash Yell, which is the biggest fails for this week in MMOs. I really liked this video. It's really stupid. It's if you don't play World of Warcraft, it's just gonna sound like complete garbage.
Should not be named.
Garbage and gibberish to you. But basically, it's a short video of this guy talking about some of the biggest fails. This guy is a gold maker. His whole entire channel is all about how to make the most amount of gold, how to make the most amount of money in World of Warcraft.
Thing that everybody wants to do in games.
Exactly. And so this is a video of the top 5 fails that he has gotten. Some of them are really dumb, like, oh, this guy vendored this thing instead of putting it on the auction house. Stupid. Ha ha ha. But the one that made me really laugh is someone was specifically farming this item. He knew the value of this item. He put it on the auction house with that item, with that value. But he screws up and it's an add-on. And as Krug can contest, if you don't set your add-ons up right, you're fucked. And so this guy doesn't set his add-ons right. And it says, oh, if the overall auction house price reduces to below your amount, automatically put the price at the secondary price. But he didn't ever set it up, and it defaults to 1 gold.
Oh.
And so he puts this item on there, and of course the auction house drops below his range, and it automatically resets it all down to 1 gold. Someone bought it in 29 seconds, bought all 200 stacks of this item. He makes, like, I think he makes like 100 gold off of it, because they take a little bit off of it. He makes like 100 gold off of this, and the guy turns around and re-puts it on the auction house for 11,000 gold.
Oh, sweet Jesus, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
And the guy...
I kind of used to be that guy in those games where we're like, oh, that's the market price. I'm just going to go 10% lower.
Yeah, and that's and that's fine. That's completely fine. But the fact is that it went from like each one of them being worth 500 gold down to 1 gold. And then, someone's just like, buy it all. Fucking buy it all. Every single one of them. I mean, and there's some other fails in there, like people forgetting to add a 0 at the end of something. So they end up selling a 10,000 gold piece item for only 1,000. And so, I mean, there's some really funny stuff in there about that. But that was what I could find for fails this week. If you guys know any more fails, please let us know.
So before we go, I have a question I want to ask you guys. It doesn't have to be a whole big discussion, but I'm curious about your opinions on it. Because I'm seeing this, I don't know if it's a trend or a shift or anything else, but I noticed that other games are trying new ways of playing. And what I mean is, we're so used to games with what we call the Holy Trinity, the DPS, the tank, and the healer, that there are games coming out now that tend to eschew that whole promise. So they're like Guild Wars 2 and Bladed Soul are two big ones where they say, you know, we don't really care about the Holy Trinity. Everyone can do some form of X or Y. And then the encounters are changed to that degree. So the question I really have for you guys and for myself, I guess, as well, is should the Holy Trinity stay as a staple from games coming here on out? Or should it go, or does it really just depend on the way you want your game to play? Like, do we have to stick to the Holy Trinity all the time?
You want to take this one first, Ballhalter?
I don't think you need to stick to it all the time. And actually, I like the fact that more games are coming out that delve into other ways of playing, because it keeps things fresh and keeps things new. I would love to see one of those really shake out and be a standout. But I don't think you need to keep the Trinity all the time. But I also think that it's probably not going to go away anytime soon. It's become such a staple and such a standard that it's comfortable. People are used to playing the roles that they want to play in every single game, and they're going to stick to that, and they're going to just gravitate towards playing that way.
I want to respond back to chat real quick, so I need to go ahead and start talking.
I already responded. The Division is definitely going to fall in the rotation.
So, my thought on...
That game's an MMO. Did you guys know that?
It is!
Yes! Yes!
I was so confused for the longest time. Drew
pulls up his mic.
This is a server announcement to let you know that the Division is not an MMO. Thank you for listening. Goodbye.
Oh, it's totally
new server announcements.
It's one of the newer MMOs that I've been looking at.
Yes, yeah. The Division
also
is...
no Holy Trinity.
Correct.
Everyone's got skills.
As far as we're aware, like there could still be a Holy Trinity. Again, we talked a little bit about that last week. The fact is that you will be upgrading different parts of your building, basically, and so you could focus towards healing or focus towards tech. I think
it was
like
a dedicated.
Yeah, correct. I like the idea of being able to swap around. There are some games, Skyforge, where you could literally just like swap over completely to DPS. You're like, oh, I'm done being a tank. I'm going to switch over to DPS. I am not a huge fan of...
fight, though?
No, it was like in between combat. So you guys could be fighting and then just like... Like, you know how right now in most MMOs, you can be a tank or a DPS or a DPS and a healer. Mm-hmm. I'm cool with that. I like that idea. But this game was literally like each player is a tank, a healer, and a DPS. And they can swap out at any time. But they completely change from like, I'm a shielded warrior that's got full plate armor. And then they're like, oh, I need to switch over to DPS. Now I can cast magic spells that you couldn't cast before. Like, I hate that idea of it. But games that allow you to have... like points over in healing and points over in DPS and, oh, you want to take a little less damage. I really love that idea. Like, I think the importance of the Holy Trinity is always sort of there, no matter what kind of game you're playing. It is kind of important to have someone that is, you know, healing specific, even games that don't have dedicated healing classes, having someone that's like, I've got heals or I've got buffs. And I can buff us. I think I like the idea of the Holy Trinity. I do like the idea that we're going away from dedicated Holy Trinity people. I'm excited to see the progression as it goes.
See, I don't mind non-Holy Trinity games. The problem is that I end up falling out. This is a personal opinion. I end up falling out with the game because of the group encounters never feeling like they do anything else but devolving into just a brawl. Just do as much fucking damage as you can so no one dies and we'll be cool. Like, Guild Wars 2 has that. You know, when you're down, you have people can pop you back up and whatnot. But it feels like you're just all throwing wet noodle sponges at a wall, and hopefully the wall gets knocked down. Blade and Soul has the extra lives concept where it's like a fighting game. You know, you really do have to worry about your own mechanics. If you play your mechanics well, even in this giant group area, you may not even take any damage, which is super cool and a super unique aspect to it. So the game focuses less on tanks and healing, while some of the classes can do a little more damage taking. You're like, hey, your skills dictate whether or not you succeed. But like I said, it just feels like you're just pummeling as fast as you can. And I really do enjoy the Holy Trinity system. And I like the fact that games are given more flexibility when you're short on a roll. Yeah. Or a roll might have a little more of a twinge. So like, say you get a warrior who is primarily a tank, but he's got a little more damage on his side, or a little more like support on his side. Case in point, you know, we said a lot this week, WildStar, World of Warcraft, when it had all the other trees and like 30 million points in there, it wasn't just like your skills. Even your skills now, like if you go into Prot, you can still have skills that are more oriented to utility, or skills that are more oriented to survivability when you go into your talent points. Like those always, I felt, was a good way to give enough of a specialization to your class without feeling like you're purely the meat machine. I really hope that someone can like make a few games, or if people can make a few games, where I don't have to feel that the Holy Trinity has to always be there primarily. Because like I said, the two other biggest games, people love it, but you never hear about how good their group content is. I wonder why. Where other games, you're like, well, you know, PvP is a little borked because of X, Y, and Z, but it's still solid. But hey, you know, those group mechanics are bomb as hell because we have our healer, we have our DPS, we have our tank. So I kind of feel to me that there's points to both, but I really so much enjoy the Holy Trinity. And I feel like sometimes these games make them and forget it on purpose. Say, fuck it, we don't need it anymore because it's an old byproduct of an old age.
Yeah. Like,
there's a reason why it's still around at everything.
Yeah.
But that's just me. So I think that was a fun. I just wanted to kind of get your opinions on that and kind of think about, you know,
yeah, what's for going sure.
on with that. We'll probably have that question again when we have like more guests on, and later on down the road when we get more games coming out that we haven't seen. So this is pretty much coming up to the end of Slash Yell. And as always, we love to just tell people about where else you can find us, what else we are doing. So you can always come see us on, you know, on our own little playing fields. So Behalter, where can we find you and what else do you like to do?
Well, you can find me mostly on Twitter. At Simply Pete is my handle. And you can listen to me on the Wildcast podcast. And you can reach us at Wildcast Podcast on Twitter.
They're awesome. Seriously, I still listen to them. Even when they make fun of us. And rightfully so. Indigo, where can we find you?
You can email me at indigo@qtimes.com. You can also hit me up on Twitter at IndigoJonesQT. That is the letter Q and the letter T, to be more specific. And if you want to email Doc, myself, and Krug all at the same time, you can email us at yell@qtimes.com. Doc, lead us out.
Best way to find me is at DocQT on Twitter, DahkQt. Also in the future, keep an eye out for this because I need to make money.
And for those listening,
and you need to look good. Podcast, you need to look good.
He's saying Trash Panda, which is his t-shirt company, and it's a t-shirt that says Wookiee's Cookies, and it's got a picture of a Wookiee.
Look, even Chewbacca needs to lay down here once in a while. I'm totally shilling the shit out of this right now.
They're chewy cookies. Get it? Get it?
Ah. Haven't made a profit yet, so Disney can't sue me. Anyway, this is Slash Well for this week. Catch Wildcast, catch Player's Handbook, catch Quarter Up, and catch us next Sunday at 5 p.m. PDT. Everyone else, have a good night.
If you like this video, make sure to click down there and like and subscribe this video. Also, there should be some annotations right below me if you want to see more content just like this. Thanks for watching, guys.